thank you for being with us. It's a real treat to have you. And these people have found a physical home, but more importantly, I think that they're looking for an emotional home, a place to belong, a place to build relationships, a place to find meaning in life. And of course, I believe the best place to do that is at a dynamic church that teaches them the key in life is to find a relationship with Jesus Christ.
So much growth as a family since attending Springbrook. We really enjoy calling Springbrook home. We really feel like we're with family.
Our family is here every Sunday. I can't tell you how much it means for us to be here every week. To receive God's word, to be around good Christian people, to praise and worship the Lord, to genuinely grow as Christians.
I want to thank you as your pastor for catching the vision. Friends, it's happening at Springbrook. You're taking ownership and God's going to do awesome things through us, I can tell you.
Went 10 innings, bottom of the 10th, to against Montreal hit a walk-off home run, huh? What a way to celebrate the division title, right? And it was great that all the players came out, just formed in a big group, and I was near them. That's a picture. And there, see? You see they're down there? See they're down there? They're in the picture with me. I was a part of it. No doubt. This is special. This was my t-shirt. Just one before I die. Come on, come on. Did you see the White Sox? They started in 1903. They won in 1906. And the Cubs had back-to-back World Series in 7 and 8. Now, of course, the White Sox won in 2005. You White Sox fans? Clap. What's going on here? This is a Cubs church. Sox church. Do it on the street, man. Do it on the street. Yeah. Now, they won in 2005. That means you need to wait another 100 years. 100 years. Just get some videos of the 2005 games. Watch them over. We don't have videos from when we won the first place. Yeah, it's really hard to decide what I was going to teach on at our 20th anniversary. I was talking to people, I was praying, getting all different kinds of ideas. But I had to come back to the most important truth that we celebrate, and that is the good news of Jesus Christ. Good news of Jesus Christ. Amen. And why I want to do this, guests, thank you so much for being here. Now, we really appreciate you taking your time to come out and celebrate with us. We hope you enjoy your time here at Springbrook. Especially for you guests, I want to show you what drives Springbrook. What is the motivation in the organization that keeps us going year after year after year? Now the Cubbies, we all know what that is, right? It's business, the bottom line, the almighty dollar. John Lester gets $25 million a year. $25 million! There are some poor Cubs, I'm gonna make like 500, so I think John can help them out in our hard time. I mean, really? Wow, it's big business, as you know. Now, if you go over to a nonprofit organization, they're just trying to help people. Turning Point, UNICEF, all the different types of nonprofits are out there, and that's really good. But friends, our bottom line, what we really feel is important, what we invest resources, time, and energy of our people is saving people from eternal death. I think it's so important for all of us to be reminded of that. That that's what we're doing. God is using us to guide people to Christ. They will not have to experience eternal death. I tell you, I really believe that. And if you really start thinking about that, it's going to happen if you're a Christ follower. You're going to become more and more motivated to be a light, tell others about the good news of Jesus Christ. You know, it all started out real well with Adam and Eve, right? There was no sin there. They were walking around enjoying God, enjoying all the trees. What a incredible garden that was. But they mission, chose to go their own way instead of God's way. So God had to kick them out of the garden in order that they would live in eternal death and sin entered the world. And you look at every problem on this earth, it's caused by sin. Whether it be the earth, you know, tornadoes, hurricanes, disrupted the whole Earth's atmosphere, the way things flow. Think of cancer, think of other type of fatal diseases. Think of difficulties that people live with. It's all because of sin. We were born sinners, because that was passed down from Adam and Eve through the generations, and we inherited a sinful orientation. Like, let's talk about one couple. Oh yeah, they're back there. Yeah, they're from Darren Chesky's church in Indianapolis, which is Heartland. It's a great church. So good to have you guys. But they have a five-week-old there. Oh, it's beautiful. Five-week-old. I don't mean to offend you guys, okay? But that five-week-old is a sinner. Okay? We're all born that way. Right? We have this orientation, this sinful nature that wants to rebel against God. It's a real problem. It's a real problem. So as we look at this, this of course, most well-known verse for most people, at least John 3:16, they might know what it says, but for God so loved the world. And I love to tell people about God's love. That's my greatest joy. Because people have usually grown up in churches where they didn't experience a love of God, where it seemed kind of empty, and people were not living out a transformed lives for them. And I tell you, God loves you so much, He knows everything about you. He knows more about you than you know about yourself. And He loves you perfectly. That's not what I'm thinking about. This is a creator, the Almighty God. He's always been and always will be. You know, He's thinking about you all the time. Well, I can't do that. He's God. Right? He created us. We can't understand how He did that. But He does it. And He's thinking about you this morning. Maybe He'll speak to you this morning about something. I just wish we could have a great story time on all that afternoon. Just testimony after testimony after testimony of how people have experienced God's love in their life. Pastor Rich celebrate his years here at Springbrook. Boy, I tell you, he has served us in such a wonderful way. And before that, he was in business. He was working. And he was living in a way that reflected the world. But as soon as Christ came into him, boom! It changed! It changed so much! And he went to seminary and became a pastor. Because Pastor Rich understands the reality of eternal death. Very seriously. Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The glory of God is perfection. That's what He wants from us. And obviously, we don't have it. We don't have any of it. We are sinners through and through, and any good works that we do, any people that we help, any money that we give, it doesn't count with God, because we're separated from Him. We don't have a relationship with Him. All of us have sinned. If you doubt that, talk to your wife next to you. Talk to your kids. Talk to anybody, really. Because we are all sinners. All sinners. wages of sin is death. Now, why I'm walking through this so carefully and being so frank is because I want everyone to understand what drives this church. This is not a social club. This is not just one big family that takes care of itself and that's the only purpose behind it. No, there's something much greater that drives us. For the wages is something you deserve, right? A sin is death. So, if you go throughout life and don't embrace Jesus Christ as your Savior, you'll face eternal death. Jesus Christ talked more about hell than heaven. Twice as much. Jesus Christ, he believed in hell. Hell, you know, there's many different descriptions of eternal fire, lake of fire. Again, we're not sure exactly what it would be. It would be figured out. I don't know, maybe. But all I know, other pastors I've heard, it's going to be a place of loneliness. You know, guys are joking around, yeah, we'll have a great time in hell. We're going to be separated from heaven. There won't be anyone. And you will be crushed with loneliness and despair, pain, and anguish. You see, the doctrine of hell is so critical to the doctrine of the gospel. Like, oh, I got saved. You know, some people don't realize what they're saved from. It wasn't fully explained, right? They were saved from eternal death. So friends, as I think about that, man, Jesus Christ is my Lord. When I was 5 years old, I asked Jesus to be my Lord and Savior. And all my life I've been committed to telling people about Jesus. Because if they don't hear about Jesus, or they reject Jesus, I don't even want to think about it. So I'm so specific here, because you need to know what drives this church. What has driven us for 20 years? Why do we have people come out every Sunday morning to worship? Why do we have, you know, all kinds of people involved in ministry, serving our children this morning, serving our children in Awana, serving our youth, serving the food, serving the communion. Why? Because we want to tell as many people as we can that they have a serious problem. And they need Jesus. And of course they say, well, they don't listen. That's okay. They just need to know. Oh, they get mad at me. I understand that. I don't want people mad at me, but think about it. Would you rather just say, okay, I don't want to be bold enough to talk to my neighbor or friend or whatever, you know, but you're not a Christ follower. So I'm getting down right to the core. Because you see, if there wasn't such a serious situation that people will be headed into if they don't embrace Christ. I mean, if you really believe, you are going to take action. You're called as ambassadors of Jesus Christ to spread this good news. And yeah, I mean, it's not easy sometimes. Think of the slayings of Christians in Iraq and other places. it just kills you that Jesus Christ said, when you bring the truth of the gospel, they will persecute you. Because they don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear about God. Now, the truth is, for the wages, what you deserve is death. Eternal death. But, don't you like those buts? Not your buts. Alright. But, the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. There's a way! Yeah, there's a way for people to be saved. There's a way for people to be kept out of hell. And it's right here. And it's free. It's free. Whenever you look at something that says free, you're probably skeptical at first. Yeah, I like what I think of my life. You know, sometimes you get nice things away free. It's a free gift. Now, what's your imagination? Okay? How many really are diehard Cubs fans? Raise your hand. I mean, it runs through. I'm looking forward to you guys. Yeah, Dan, Shannon, Deacon back here, I mean, they're over the top in a very positive way, okay? I mean, they named their daughter Wrigley with an R, right? Wrigley with an R. And I just love those guys so much. I just miss her. It's free. So let's say you're Dan Deacon, okay? Stand up for a second, Dan. Where are you, buddy? There, everybody look at Dan. Got his cup shirt on. Dan, all right. Now, I hear, Dan, that they are selling World Series tickets. And that just for standing room, $2,500. Are you going to pay that kind of money?
No.
Oh, yeah, I wouldn't either. That's unbelievable. I mean, the seats that we were in, the nosebleed, those go for $3,000, and it's just on the way up. So let's say Dan is down at Wrigley Field and can't afford to go in, but he just wants to be there. He wants to feel the excitement. He wants to hear the roar of the crowd. He wants to hear the clack of the band. He is there just to experience it. Of course, he can't go in. $3,000, you gotta get it. But then, what if a man walked out of home and he said, trying to jack some balls here on Sheffield? Dan says, no, I'm just here for the experience. Why don't you go in? I don't have $3,000. And this man says, you know what? I am going to gift you with the best seats. You and I are going in there, and we are sitting in the Cubs dugout. If you can figure out a better seat, I'll take you there. And Dan, that's just unbelievable. You just have to wait to say, am I in a dream? And you realize that it's Jesus. You realize that it's Jesus. Now, I know you're a Christ follower, Dan, but let's pretend you're not. And you say, Jesus, oh, unbelievable. I mean, I tell you what I'm going to do for you. I'm going to go to three different Sunday services at different churches a week. I am going to go to every Bible study I can. One Bible study a day. I'm going to go to the pastor of these churches and say, I will serve anywhere. I will do anything. Let me do it, Jesus. And Jesus would look at Dan and say, you don't understand. There's nothing you can do to give you what I have. What you need to do is humble yourself. Because arrogance is the number one reason people turn away from Christianity, because if you're going to become a Christ follower, you have to recognize I'm a sinner, and there's serious judgment ahead. And so, God, I just come with nothing that I have would impress you at all, because I'm a sinner, and I just want that free gift of salvation. I want to be transformed. I want to be your child. I want to spend eternity with you. That is the beauty of the gospel. And it's better than any seat you could have in the world service. Jesus said to them, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except. What did he say again? Except.
Through me.
Through me? Oh, close my eyes, Jesus. Hey, there's a lot of great people all over the world, Buddhists and Muslims and Hindus. And they have great religions, school people think. I mean, you are so arrogant to say that Jesus is the only way.
Amen.
Yeah. You know why? Because even though people are not viewing things with absolute truth, if they can absolute out, it's good for them. We still believe that we should stop at stoplights, right? Now, if you just don't say, I'm going to mix it up a little bit. Red means go faster. And then yellow means to go faster than that. And green, just put it to the floor. Now, can you personally reinterpret the lights? Well, you could, but it'd be fear for your life. You see, all these world religions are performance-based. Okay, Hindus, you know, gotta come and worship the gods, all the different gods, and you hopefully will earn their favor. And every world religion is like that. It's performance based. You've got to do something, and you've got to do a lot of things in order to make sure you get to whatever a higher place is. So really, they're all exclusive, aren't they? Every religion, not universalism, but all the major religions say, you've got to do this. Well, how can five major religions be wrong? I mean, you can't mix and match them, guys. They'll say, you've got to follow us, or, and Jesus Christ is saying, you have to follow me, or. The most important decision you make in your life is who is Jesus Christ. Now, every religion likes to throw him in there as a good teacher. But you can't do that, can you? Because he claimed to be God. So if he claimed to be God, the one and only true God, we better obey him. Because if he isn't God, he's crazy, right? He's a lunatic. He doesn't know what he's talking about. Or he was a liar. Three options, guys. Everyone in this room has to say he was a lunatic, he was a liar, or he is my Lord. Everyone has to make a decision about Jesus. And if you ever hear anybody say, oh, Jesus was a good teacher, bring up that logic. Wait a second. You say he's a good Jesus, good teacher. But he said he was God. He said he's the only way to heaven. How does that figure in? Is that good teaching? No, it's not. Unless you believe that He is the Lord. And friends, studying the world religions, the most beautiful thing, again, they're all performance-based. Everyone, you have to do things. You have to serve. You have to, give to the idols. You've got to pray regularly. Whatever it is. But with Christianity, all you have to do is humble yourself. Say, God, I am a sinner. I'm headed toward eternal death, but I want your salvation. I want to accept what you did on the cross. It's just amazing. God was holy, so somebody had to pay. Somebody had to pay for the penalty. And so he sent his own son down, virgin birth, so he was fully a representative of us, but also fully representative of God. There was no sin in him. And he fulfilled the law that was taught in the Old Testament to the T. And that made him the perfect person to give their life, give his life for us. No sin upon him at all. I remember when the darkness came over, the crucifixion, and all the sins of the world, past, present, future, were laid upon Jesus Christ. God had to turn his face away. What was he doing? Jesus Christ, part of the Godhead. Jesus Christ was dying so that you and I could have a relationship with him. Well, that's love, isn't it? That's love. So it shows how just our God is. It has to happen. We're not saying, hey, it's okay. No! He is perfectly just, but at the same time, he is perfectly loving. And he made a way for us to have a relationship with him. And so, right now, if you have become a Christ follower, he views you in white. Because all the sins that you have committed, past, present, or future, were wiped off the books when you became a Christian. There is no reason for you to feel guilty. Right? If God, the creator of the universe, forgave you, what are you still blaming yourself for? That's one of the wonderful things about becoming a Christ follower, is it frees you. If the Almighty God forgives me, I can forgive myself. Romans 10:9-10. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved from eternal death. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved from eternal death. What do you need to do? Become a Christ follower. You need to confess with your mouth. Jesus Christ is my Lord. I'm giving up all my life. I'm giving over to Him. He's going to direct me and He's going to obviously make my life. It's a wonderful thing. Always be troubles on earth, but in eternity, you want to have the struggle. And believe in your heart. That word believe. Believe and repent are many times used. And they're almost synonyms. It's the idea of changing your direction. So if you are on a sinful path, and God transforms you, and He fills you with His Holy Spirit, He transforms the way that you live. And slowly, you work on those sinful issues in your life, and He gives you victory over them. Where the heart one believes and is justified, and the mouth one confesses and is saved. Ephesians 2:8-9. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It's a gift of God. Not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. He has to keep saying that, right? Because nobody believes him. You can't get something for free. Well, you can. If you submit to Jesus Christ, claim him as Lord and Savior, it won't cost you anything. You say, well, I'd have to keep working after I become a Christian. No. You don't have to again, earn your salvation. But you're probably naturally going to do it. The Holy Spirit's within you. But again, I often ask people, if you die tonight, do you think you go to heaven or not? And ultimately, 90% of the people say, it's because I tried to be a good person. That's the wrong answer. You're not getting anywhere. So I have the joy of sharing that. It's incredible news about God and how much He loves. He doesn't have to work for it. Once He becomes a Christ follower, He'll be overtaken. Luke 15, 6 or 7. Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Let's talk with Mike Hughes. What if the Cubs did win the World Series? What would happen? Here in Chicago. I mean, just think about it. There are Cub fans all over the world. They've been losers for so long. Everybody loves a loser, right? I mean, this place would go ballistic. I was at the Bears in 85 when they came back, and I was talking with Mike. He was there too, and he almost gets sucked into the bus because people keep pushing and pushing and pushing. That's not right. The point is, it's going to be mad. It's going to be a madhouse. But you know what this verse says? Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents. That means the Spirit speaking here right now and saying, yeah, this is a new way to look at things. I've heard this before. And this is something I should do. It. Make that decision. There's going to be a bigger celebration in heaven that will not even compare to any type of World Series celebration. Imagine that! You always tell people that after you get Christ's heart, you get to throw a party for you. Where's the cake? Unbelievable party that goes on. And that's why we value everyone who comes to Christ. Whether they be 5-year-old, 10, 30, 50, 70, it's a win for the kingdom. That person is saved from eternal death. This is a prayer. This is from the Bible, but it has Bible-based themes that we talk about. Let me read through it. Lord Jesus, I want to know you personally. Thank you. Dying on the cross for my sins. I ask forgiveness for my sins and open the door of my life and receive you as my Savior and Lord. I no longer trust in my good mercy in a relationship with you. I know now there's a free gift on a grace-based relationship instead of a performance-based relationship. I know now I have a free gift. Thank you for giving my sins. Giving me eternal. If you understand that, if you want that, all you have to do is read that. Well, that's way too easy. Anybody can do it. Yeah. I don't want to do anything anybody can do. I'm special. Hey, help yourselves, man. Make an accurate assessment of where you're at in your relationship. Now again, the reason I shared the gospel message, because it's at the core of everything we've done over the last 20 years. And I think we've seen 1,000, 2,000 people come to the Lord, or cry for more. But that's what we're about, so that's a win. It's not money. It's changed lives when people hear about Jesus. I don't know where you are. You're having your spiritual journey. And maybe you're thinking, hey, I've heard this before. It doesn't make sense to me. Well, I would encourage you to continue to, again, answer that question. Who is Jesus Christ? Brothers of you, well, that's interesting. That's a different few different things. Well, check this out more. And we'd love to help you out anyway. Maybe some of you say, what with the Holy Spirit? Pull me over in my chair. How did I become a Christian today? We can do that. We're saying that prayer. And please tell us, if you want to know more about Christianity or you want to more about salvation, please tell us. We would love to explain to you. Next, we're going to look at a video of people at Springbrook and some of their memories.
Regularly attending for 15 years. I've been going to Springbrook for maybe 2 years now.
We've been coming for 3 years. 19 and a half years.
3 years now.
10 years.
18 years.
4 years now.
It's been a year now.
I've called Springbrook home for 10 years now.
16 years. 17 years.
I want to say 3 years.
I've had a lot of favorite memories. Well, like the small groups, it's something that I love to, that it's like helping me, you know, that I can open up and I can share with other people of God. So it's something that I love to never been part of it before this time.
One of my favorite memories is meeting the people here. All the people that I've met.
It's a very welcoming place and just how friendly everyone is and how easy it is to chat with.
My friends and I would always go and like try to explore if we used to meet at Jacobs High School. So we all go and explore Jacobs High School, and one time I got lost.
We had our first service here, and I was just praising God after being in the elementary school and the high school, being in the hallways and helping with the Awana classes. And it was just amazing when we came into this church and we had our own place.
Was when we first came, we were walking and showed our children who were 2, 3, and 4 at the time where to take them. And the next week we came back and they remembered us and says, oh, do you know where to take your children? I said, yes, we do.
For me, when we were looking for a church body to join up here in Chicagoland, we wanted to find one with a small group. And this church has that, and we just love participating in a small group.
I also really enjoyed the men's breakfast a lot. I always go to those, and it's always a fun time to meet up with other guys, and we're able to communicate and just talk about Christ. And it was a great way for me to relate with other men and problems that we all face.
I think it's just such a home feel. You just feel once you get past the meeting of new people, and you know that like preliminary fear moment where you're like you're new to the church, but once you get past that, it's really a great family oriented. I know everybody, and for myself too, to get out of that shell, saying hi to people that maybe I haven't said hi to before. So it's a very, and once you get past that, it is a very family oriented environment.
Seeing people coming to Springbrook, knowing that that's God at work, the spiritual growth that I've had here. It was here in Springbrook that I rededicated my life to Christ, then joined my first small group, got involved in serving.
Well, I like how we go to small groups and say how we what we've been doing and everything.
Our small group is our family, and when we have things to celebrate, we can celebrate with our small group.
When I first came here, I was not a Christ follower. So after being here for several months and hearing Pastor Dan's sermons, it brought me to Christ. It made me understand the whole gospel, which I never really did before.
It has been great to see them grow up in a place where they love the Lord, where they come home talking.
stories, ideas where so many different people have poured into them, adults and other leaders, and that is, I don't know how a parent could ask for more than to watch their children grow to love the Lord from so many different people pouring into them.
Even though I'm in my senior years, I'm still growing. He still touches my life, and I don't know it until after he's touched it, and I go back and I go, oh, that was God's doing, not mine.
Here you can be new, you can be old, you can be anybody, and they will take you in with open arms.
Because it's just a community, and everybody comes here when they're looking in need, and God always accepts them here.
The family makes it great. And the same thing, just is the fact that we're able to serve. That's just, it's a blessing. Just, I think mostly for us, just to be able to have that opportunity.
There's a lot of people that go to church on Sunday and then leave. And here, it's made up of a community of people that are all willing to help each other out. And they check in on each other, and you're truly a church. You're truly a community together, working towards, you know, spreading the word.
As we're being told by Pastor Dan to be a people of prayer and to put, kind of live out what he's teaching us and what the Bible teaches us, I think the more we do that, we will see more people be drawn into Springbrook to be a part of what we're doing.
I think a church that looks to their children and spends money and commits time to their children is a church that's going to grow and meet the needs in the neighborhood. And I appreciate that about our church.
I see God working in so many different ways by improving our community. It's not just the church itself, but what it does in the community.
I would like to see God grow this church to its full capacity and be able to finish the vision of building the top floor out of this building and just have this building to its full capacity. It brings many people.
Amen.
All right, friends, we're going to have a little time of celebration here.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Our purpose for being here today was to really focus on thanking God. He's been so faithful to us over these 20 years, and we really, really are indebted to him. And we wanted to just take that time to make sure he was recognized for all he's done here. And in addition to that, there's one more we want to thank, and that's Dan Harrison. Dan is pretty happy. He has taught us, he has led us, he's been the vision pastor, and we have been blessed because of that, so I'm just thankful for your faithfulness to him. And Lori, I thank you too. Quietly is behind the scenes and supporting Dan and everything he does here. And that's a long time to make a high priority for what's going on in Springbrook. Valuing that as highly as they value God. And Lord, I thank you for your commitment to a lot of and many lives from us to build that. So we have been blessed by your presence.
Your encouragement.
but you guys are just so gentle, caring, encouraging, loving, discipling me, growing me, discipling my kids. A great place to be. Thank you again. Who you are. Yeah. All right, let's get back to Let's Celebrate. Now, we're going to just go through a run through here. And what's going to happen is that we're going to praise God for 20 years of changed lives in Springbrook. And now, Lincoln Hills Elementary School, just think to yourself, okay, that's when I came to Springbrook. Because when we say it in the midst of our cheer, we want you to stand up. Okay? And if you were at, you had to repeat a grade, Jacobs High School, 1999 to 2006. So if you're in that group, at the moment you'll stand. Huntley Ministry Center, call this a ministry center. We started in school. We call this a church building, but the church is you guys, right? It's all of us who know Jesus with the Holy Spirit within us. And we've chosen to become a part of this local body. So if you came and there in 2007 to 2012, or 2007 to 2000. Wow. Yeah, that's how we're going to step through it. Okay, and then we'll thank God at the end. Let's really celebrate here. And we get started. 3, 2, 1, cheers!
Thank you.
energy and sing this song to the Lord.
No.